Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good morning, dear members of the European Parliament, ladies and gentlemen. And yes, I'm from Kazakhstan, but I was trained both in Kazakhstan and the US, and I'm in your part. For years, I worked discreetly on Kazakhstan-related politically motivated cases. I worked with NGOs on a pro bono basis on situation of torture and persecution of political activists. Many workers like me in Kazakhstan are afraid to publicly defend victims of torture and politically persecuted people. The Belgian authorities granted me a political asylum because there is a risk that I faced as a lawyer and human rights defender. I've been target of a kidnapping plot, of electronic and physical surveillance, of a smear PR campaign. I faced attempts to have me arrested through the abuse of Interpol and fabricated allegations of crime. None of those actions actually worked to stop me, and then my brother Iskander Yerimbetov, who lives in Kazakhstan, was arrested. And, or more precisely, he was taken hostage. And it happened both as a reprisal to punish me for my work and as a means of compelling me to stop working. When arrested, my brother was told that if he convinces me, political refugee here in Belgium, to come back to Kazakhstan and give false testimony against people that I defended, that the criminal charges against him will be dropped. My brother refused and he was brutally tortured for over 2 months. The authorities wanted him also to collaborate with the investigation, and which meant for them signing false testimonies about fabricated charges. And last October, despite the indictment lacking any elements of the crime, my brother was sentenced to 7-year prison term. And why this happened to me and my family. To explain why lawyers are persecuted by the state, or more broadly, what's happening in Kazakhstan with the legal profession and judiciary, it's important to understand political development of modern Kazakhstan that sometimes being overlooked. Since its independence in 1991, Kazakhstan established the essential element of the market-oriented economy, as well as the facade of democratic institution. In reality, the state functions as a highly authoritarian and repressive regime. President Nursultan Nazarbayev has ruled Kazakhstan since 1991. Elections, whether parliamentary or presidential, are neither free or fair. For example, in the last elections, President Nazarbayev won with 97.75% of the vote. Any opposition is severely repressed. For example, in March of last year, the authorities declared the opposition Democratic Choice of Kazakhstan movement, which existed only online, to be an extremist organization. Its supporters have faced persecution and imprisonment, as well as the lawyers who try to defend those people. They face persecution as well. There is no independent free press in Kazakhstan. All media outlets, including news websites, are either in the state hands, owned by Nazarbayev's family or his cronies, or under control of the presidential administration or the KNB, which is the secret police in Kazakhstan. People receive real terms for posting and reposting legitimate political commentary on social network. Since last year, the authorities have thrown or entirely shut off the internet during live broadcasts of the opposition. Freedom of the assembly is severely restricted as well. The regime has invented a new method of limiting protest. People get arrested preemptively, usually on the eve of any publicly announced protest. Last year, activists Almaz Jumabay, Kenchibek Abishev, Almaz Jumagulov, and Aset Abishev received prison sentences for social media activities and peaceful protests. Their defense lawyers all experienced political pressure from police and judges. One of the activists in the protest against the absurd and baseless allegations against him and the violation of his procedural right cut his wrist during the hearings. But disciplinary actions were actually taken by the court against his lawyer as a scapegoat for allegedly not preventing that desperate act of protest, like lawyer could do something about it. Corruption is endemic at all levels of government, and the presidential family and closely related business groups have consolidated political and economic power. Persecution for corruption typically happens only because of internal power struggle. Meanwhile, persecution for alleged financial crime is a weapon of choice used against journalists, activists, and opposition figures. And at the same time, the government invests heavily in state propaganda that conveys false narrative of a successful and legitimate regime. Abroad, mainly in the EU and US, the state spends heavily on public relations campaigns. Lobbyists and PR companies are hired either directly by the government agencies such as Ministry of Justice or indirectly through private companies controlled by Nazarbayev's inner circle. PR campaigns seek to project Kazakhstan as a thriving, stable, and state and reliable partner. They attempt to whitewash and scrutinize realities of corruption and human rights violation and try to discredit regime opponents and human rights defenders. This year is particularly important for Kazakhstan. We are anticipating presidential elections. We don't know exactly when. In Kazakhstan, the regime doesn't announce the elections until the last moment. In 2018, Nazarbayev signed a decree making him chairman of the country's Security Council for life. This decree gave the Security Council significant institutional powers, which allowed Nazarbayev to maintain his power even if he vacates the presidency. The survival of such a regime relies upon control of the prosecutorial and judicial system. Judicial system is under control of a strict hierarchy, especially noticeable in politically motivated cases. The judges of first instance cannot make decisions without approval or direct instructions of the superior judge. And it goes up the chain to the Supreme Court, which is controlled by the chairman of the Supreme Court. And the chairman in turn takes instructions or coordinates the decisions with the head of the secret police, the Ministry of Justice, the prosecutor general, and the presidential administration. A recent example happened in the city of Aktau. On February 6th, in a politically motivated case, a judge acquitted an activist as a mother of four, Aygul Akbyudeeva. She was accused of calling for seizure of power after critical comments on Telegram application. The prosecutor demanded that Akbyudeeva be sentenced for 5 years, but the judge acquitted the activist. It happens with the approval of the supervising judge, the chairman of the city court, because without the approval, the judge cannot make any decision. The next day, the chairman of the city court was removed from his post. His powers as a judge were terminated. The state-controlled media started a smear campaign against the judge, and the regime made it clear that it will immediately punish those judges who dare issue independent decisions in politically motivated cases. In Kazakhstan, the most popular measure that the regime uses to intimidate voice is to revoke their license, or threaten to revoke. That gives the authorities a way of keeping those lawyers whom they consider problematic out of the profession. And in my country, problematic lawyers are those who take part in politically motivated cases, cases of torture, who defend political opponents, and do not agree to collude with the prosecution. Such lawyers are in constant danger. And the procedural independence of defense lawyers is extremely low or non-existent. That is why in my country, like considering what I said, the legal profession in the field of human rights has been gutted for the entire generation, and it's now on the verge of being completely wiped out. What can be done in these bleak circumstances with the legal professions in Kazakhstan. More than 400 citizens of Kazakhstan have signed a petition asking the European Parliament to adopt a resolution on human rights and publicly condemned political persecution in Kazakhstan. And you should understand, for those who signed the petition, they face real risk of a real prison sentence. Based on what I experienced in Kazakhstan, my recommendations both to the European Parliament and to the European External Action Services will be the following. First is public condemnation of critical reports of cruel treatment and political persecution is extremely important. It is crucial to stress the need to respect and to guarantee the independence of lawyers, to cease their persecution and to ensure their safety. I also echo the recommendations of the European Parliament, Parliament's 2016 and 2017 resolution, especially that Kazakhstan, EU-Kazakhstan human rights dialogue should be effective and result-oriented. And those dialogues should be conducive to the establishment of a forum where issues can be discussed openly and publicly. The rules of procedure of the EU-Kazakhstan Parliamentary Cooperation Committee, PCC, must become more transparent, and platforms should be established to evaluate the enhanced partnership and cooperation agreement. The PCC must become a place where human rights and civil society issues are publicly and effectively discussed. Compliance with Kazakhstan's obligation under the international law must be an important condition for further cooperation between the EU and Kazakhstan. There should be full compliance by Kazakhstan with its legal obligation as set forth in the communication from UN Human Rights Committee, UN Committee Against Torture, and UN Working Group on Arbitrary Detention. And I also want to add, given Kazakhstan's persistent refusal to allow an independent international investigation into the genocide massacre of 2011, personal sanctions should be applied against the officials responsible for the shooting and the attempt to cover up. I believe that there is a hope for my country and for my people's future, but only if the European and other international influencers apply unwavering pressure on the regime that has become a serial violator of fundamental principles of human rights. We need all your help. Thank you very much.
Grazie. Questo è un'altra di quattro.